we make any political sense at all of Boris Johnson's tasteless dog whistle at burqa-wearing women? Well, it has a certain logic, at least in the reaction to it. After all, if a low-blow column in the Telegraph can fling the Tory party into such disarray, then it speaks volumes about the febrile state of British politics. It is unusual for both government and opposition to be fractured simultaneously, and unprecedented for them to be riven by disputes on anti-Semitism and Islamophobia, which on the surface at least would not be normally central to political debate. Of course, all is not as it seems. Corbyn's hapless handling of the anti-Semitism charge has allowed his many opponents, external and internal, a stick with which to flail him. Johnson's buffoonery is a prelude to a leadership bid this autumn, as May's Chequers chickens come home to roost. And therein lies the potential catalyst to break the political logjam in Britain. If Boris makes it to the starting line this autumn and then wins the Tory leadership, then inevitably there'll be an early election as the Tory party splinters and loses its Commons majority. He would then lead the Tory party into a subsequent election on a clean break ticket with Europe. In his wake, the much-touted, long-heralded centre party will finally emerge with a nucleus of pro-Europe Tory rebel MPs, Labour European anti-Corbynites and the Lib Dems. They will be bankrolled to fight the election on a second referendum to remain in Europe. And of course, the European Commission will put Brexit on hold as Britain drinks at the last chance saloon. In these circumstances, Corbyn's Labour would be left contesting that election with a decided view on everything, except, of course, on the issue with which the election will be fought, Europe. That is not, as the SNP found out last year, the ideal circumstances in which to galvanise the troops. Now, how likely is all of this? Well, there are pitfalls. Firstly, Johnson is not a man, in an old Tory phrase, to go into the jungle with. He has bottled it once, he may do so again. Secondly, the Lib Dems are both the progenitors and the obstacles to a new centre party. On the one hand, a party with less than a baker's dozen of MPs desperately needs to find a new mojo. On the other hand, the Liberal grassroots will not lightly give up their right to fail in the other 600 or so constituencies. To enforce such a deal, you would need a leader with the ruthless streak of a David Steele. Now, I know David Steele. David Steele was a presiding officer of mine. And Vince Cable, you're no David Steele. Thirdly, Boris might run and lose, in which case the splinter in the Tory party will not be from the pro-European left, but from the populist right. Interestingly, from the centre party's point of view, the odds on any other party beyond Labour or Tory winning most seats in the next election have compressed from 300 to 1 to 30 to 1. Now, before you get too excited with your hard-earned, that still puts the chances at around 3%. Mind you, the chances of the attempt being made are now very much higher. In all of this confusion, stands Scotland where it did? Well, not really. Since such an alignment election is a possibility, the SNP must be ready to fight it. And to fight it successfully, we'll need a strong position in Europe and an unambiguous position on Scotland's constitutional future. With that SNP positioning, then Westminster's mayhem might just be Scotland's greatest opportunity. However, without such a strong line, there is a potential re-emergence of the perennial risk that the subject matter of a UK election might overshadow Scottish circumstances. All of which makes for a fascinating autumn in UK politics. However, autumn is followed by winter. And winter is coming is not the most appealing prospectus for this politically septic aisle.